I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live, and everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Even so, says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. Good afternoon. My name is Mark Booker, and I serve as the senior minister here at Park Street Church. And on behalf of Ruth and Barbara and the entire Park Street Church community, of which the Brescias were such a meaningful part, I want to welcome you to this service in which we are indeed remembering the life of a man that was a husband and father and brother in Christ and friend and colleague. And all of you had some way, I'm sure, of knowing Mike Brescia, and you're here today to remember him together. And we're here to grieve, to acknowledge the reality of loss and sadness that comes in that loss, but also to lift our eyes together with Ruth and Barbara to the Lord Jesus, whom Mike trusted in, believed in, rested in, and hoped in, and to be encouraged by his word as we gather together. So I invite you into this time of worship, and if you're a visitor among us because you knew Mike, we're glad that you're here and invite you to enter into this time with us as well. Let's begin with a word of prayer. O God, who by the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light. Grant that your servant Michael, being raised with Christ, may know the strength of his presence and rejoice in his eternal glory, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Testament reading from Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well refined. And he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Please stand to recite the psalm and antiphonally. Bless the Lord,
my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy.
Who satisfies you with good, so that your youth is renewed like eagles.
The Lord works righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed.
You made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger,
from the book of Romans. For all who were led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with your spirit that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed in us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present nor things to come nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
reading from the Gospel according to John. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the gift of your word, that you speak into the darkness, into the void, into the confusion, into the grief and the pain and the sorrow. And you speak with words of life and direction and guidance and hope. And we pray, O God, that your word, which is living and active, would minister to our hearts. Particularly, we pray that for Ruth and for Barbara, that you would give them grace and peace as they mourn the loss of a husband and father. And we ask that you would give us your peace as we mourn the loss of a friend, colleague, choir member, and brother in Christ. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to be seated. Well, as I mentioned, we gather to give thanks for the life of Mike Brescia, a husband and father and engineer and follower of Jesus, and to be encouraged by the word of the God of life, to remember and be reminded of our hope and of the hope that animated our brother Mike's life. Death is never welcome, no matter when and how it comes. It always feels like a rude interruption into what should be the case. It's not the way things were meant to be. In coming to a memorial service, as we remember, honor, and celebrate Mike's life, we have to confront the reality of death. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 2 says, "It is better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting, for this is the end of all mankind, and the living will lay it to heart." So as we lay this to heart in thinking about Mike, we also lay it to heart in thinking about our own lives. And we are going to consider together the faith that animated Mike's life, a faith in the God of resurrection, the God of hope. After independently finding their way to Boston, Mike from New Jersey and Ruth from Indiana, they met here at Park Street Church in 1967, at least that's what you told me a couple of years ago, in the grad group that was started by Doug Stewart just a couple of years earlier. And they married here at Park Street Church in 1970, and they have been a faithful presence and meaningful presence, as many of you know far better than I do, in this church ever since. Mike was, I believe, best known at Park Street for his 45 years of service in the choir that we've heard from already in this service, a milestone that was recently marked by the commissioning of 7 antiphons that were premiered during worship services over the last year or so here at Park Street Church. Mike served as the choir librarian as well for some time, and all in the choir as well as in the community were blessed by Mike's presence. I'm told that Mike was generally quiet in the Bible study that he and Ruth were faithfully a part of for decades, but that when he spoke, everybody listened. Always insightful, always on target, with an incredibly sharp mind, nobody wanted to miss what Mike had to say. One of my favorite anecdotes was shared with me by Barbara when I was visiting with her and Ruth at their home, which was the fact that There was a teenage boy that would come to church around the time that you were all younger who had a mohawk and didn't dress like everybody else at Park Street, and that your dad was just treating him like everybody else, warm, affectionate, saying hello, and not being in any way put off by this young man's appearance, which was different from the norm. What a gift and a blessing. This was a life that was animated by a genuine faith in Jesus. And that's what we want to consider together briefly as we hear from the Word of God through the lens of Romans chapter 8, which was a text that I read with Ruth and Barbara on the day that Mike died at their home. We'll consider three things from this text, and if you want to grab a Bible that's in the pew in front of you and find your way, I don't know what page it's on, but find your way to Romans 8, you're welcome to. But I just put them out to you in three basic words: adoption, groaning, and union. These three things flow out of verse 1 in Romans chapter 8, in which Paul writes this: "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." To be in Christ Jesus is to believe in him, but not just to believe in some kind of cognitive way that he existed or that he was a good teacher or an interesting figure in history, but it is to believe that God himself was this man who walked upon the earth, and that he didn't come just to walk and teach, but he came to die. And he came to die for the sins of the world, your sins and my sins, our brokenness, the ways that we don't measure up and meet the design of God for human life. And that 3 days later, this Jesus was raised from the dead, never to die again, and that he lives even to the present, seated at the right hand of the Father in the throne room of the cosmos, and from which he is directing human history and ruling over all of our lives, and at which place he is interceding for us, as Paul picks up in verse 34 of Romans 8. And to believe in him is to entrust ourselves to him, it's to yield to him, it's to put our lives in his hands, not just to believe something cognitively, but to, in a sense, entrust all that we are over to his care, his lordship, his love. It's an act of yielding and surrender and trust. It's an act that Mike took in his life and lived his life by. And it leads to these three things that we see in Romans chapter 8. Adoption. We are taken up into the family of God. When by faith we're united with the Son of God, Jesus, we are brought into the family. We actually come to share in that eternal relationship of love that has always existed between the Father and the Son, animated by the Spirit. And this Spirit, Paul writes about, has been given to those who yield to Jesus, indwells us, and enables us to cry out, "Abba, Father." Paul says, "You have received the Spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father." And it's this Spirit that bears witness inside of us that we are children of God and heirs of God. David Ricks, a longtime friend of the Brescias and of Mike, shared with me this week that Mike always had a twinkle in his eye. I didn't cross-check this with Ruth, so I hope you agree. And David noted that the twinkle was still there when he last visited with Ruth, you, and Mike, and Barbara in your home. And I don't think this is just a dimension of Mike's personality, though I do believe it is that as well, of his quiet presence. But it was also no doubt the reflection in his eye of his sure and certain identity as a son of God, loved and embraced by the creator of the universe, knowing that he was not a cosmic orphan hoarding what resources he could gather for himself and his own, but rather understanding that he was the son of a king with a father who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, who had been generous toward him in his son. Groaning. Being a son does not preclude us from suffering and groaning. And this text in Romans 8 brings this tension together for those of us who follow Jesus, in saying that, verse 17, that we are heirs provided that we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified in him. This suffering leads to longing and awaiting. Paul mentions we wait eagerly. awaiting his return to make everything new. And it leads to groaning in verse 23 of Romans 8, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for the adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. No parent ever wants to lose a child. But for Mike and Ruth, that day came in 1995 when their daughter Catherine was killed in a tragic car accident at the age of 24. 2 weeks after the memorial service that was held here on June 11th, 1995, David Ricks took Mike to lunch, just as a friend. And David told me this week that during lunch, Mike, who Ruth has told me wasn't shown for or known for showing a lot of emotion in his life, just began to weep over lunch in grief over the loss of his daughter. He felt that grief. And Ruth, I know that you and you, Barbara, have lived with this grief now for nearly 30 years. And yet I didn't think we could come to this moment in remembering Mike without remembering what was such a big part of his and your lives and your journey up to this point. Because the depth of admiration I think I have for your family and that all of us have for your family in walking faithfully with the Lord Jesus after such tremendous loss and heartache, of groaning more than any of us probably know, of eagerly awaiting the transformation of this world by the grace of God, which we as Christians deeply believe is coming when Jesus returns, to bring about a world that doesn't have any more pain or tears or heartache of that kind. That in that groaning, you have nonetheless lived a life, and Mike lived this well, of walking faithfully, of rejecting bitterness and cynicism and embracing the sovereign hand of God. Mike knew what it was to groan, but he knew in the midst of that groaning that God had not forsaken him and his wife and Barbara, but was there with them, holding them in that pain. There's a special anguish for a father who loses a son or a daughter, an anguish that none of us would ever want to know. Mike groaned in that anguish, but waited. He waited for God. And now he enjoys the presence of God in a way that, my guess is, has put a lot of other things in perspective. But Mike's faith and your faith, Ruth, and your faith, Barbara, have been an example to all of us for how to walk through a world of tears and of groaning. And then there's union. We reach the end of Romans chapter 8, and we, most of us who like to study the Bible, think that this is probably the high point in many ways of the whole biblical canon. I'm sure as an engineer, Mike knew a lot more about magnetic fields than I do, and some of you sitting here probably do as well, but the last thing that we see at the end of Romans 8 is this sense in which our union with Christ is like two incredibly powerful magnets that cannot be pulled apart. Maybe in a more vernacular way, some of you have gotten 2 5-gallon buckets stuck together at your home like I have before, and it doesn't matter how hard you pull, you just can't get them apart. When we are unioned with Christ by faith, when we are in Christ Jesus, as this chapter begins in verse 1, we are union to him, we are connected to him, we are brought into his life in such a way that nothing in the world or in the cosmos can separate us from him. And Jesus is the one who has already died and risen again. And death no longer has dominion over him, and he will never die again. And our great hope as Christians is summarized and clarified in such beautiful language by Paul here at the end of Romans 8, such that nothing in the world, and Paul mentions even death itself, neither life nor death, nor anything else in all creation, can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. For us, as Christian believers, death is never the final word. It's not the end of the story. It is merely a transition from one mode of existing to another. And that other mode of existing, Paul describes in some way as seeing face to face what now we can only see as in a mirror dimly. And there is tremendous hope in that for every single one of us as we grieve the loss of this man of God. And even as we contemplate the reality of death in our own lives, we are unioned with him by faith. And Mike, and that union has not changed. It remains the reality in such a way that there is no doubt for us that Mike is being comforted and alive in joy in the presence of his King. That is our hope, even today, as we give glory to God for seeing his glory in the face of Mike, of Ruth, and of Barbara. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? You remember that picture maybe from being a child, I'm sure some of you did this, where one child is taunting another from a very safe place, usually like up in a tree, saying like, you can't hurt me, you can't hurt me. And that's what Christians can say to death itself. Yes, it does hurt in a very real sense, and it does change our lived reality. But it can't hurt us in a deep sense. It cannot change or alter the deep union that we have with the God of life in the person of Jesus. And our great hope is that one day that we will rise again as Jesus rose from the grave with new resurrection bodies that are alive and well in the new heavens and the new earth. And this is our hope even this day. This is the Christian hope. And it is a hope that is offered to all, not just merely as wishful thinking, but it is grounded on the historical reality of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And it is offered, this hope, to every single one who would turn to Jesus, who would share in the faith, the yielding, the trust, and the surrender of one's life, as Mike did, to his Lordship. Ruth and Barbara, may God be your rock and your refuge in the days ahead, in these days of mourning. And may he lead you more and more into the life and hope of Jesus, even as you grieve. And may he grant to each of us who gather here faith in his Son, the Lord Jesus, and the assurance of adoption, even as we groan, because we do, and the depth of assurance of a union that can never be broken. For we too will one day follow in Mike's footsteps to the grave. But I pray that we too all would one day follow in his footsteps into the presence of our King. Let's pray. Thank you so much, Father, for the gift of life. Thank you for the gift of a life well lived in Mike Brescia, for the gift of an example of a man who bore up under trial in the midst of the groanings of this world and demonstrated through his quiet, thoughtful presence the reality of life in your Son. God, we do pray that you would give to each of us a renewed sense of encouragement in the reality of the resurrection and this hope that nothing indeed can separate us from you. For those here with us this afternoon for whom this is a foreign message, Lord, I pray that the Spirit would open hearts and minds to know this hope as well. And we pray again for your deep encouragement and comfort to Ruth and Barbara, in Jesus' name. Let's stand together and respond to God's word with confessing our faith with the church throughout history with these words from the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I invite you to be seated or to kneel as we pray together. Let's begin by praying as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, that through the grace, grave, and gate of death, we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection. Lord, in your mercy, grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days. Lord, in your mercy, grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you in faithful obedience. Lord, in your mercy, grant to all who mourn a sure confidence in your fatherly care, that casting their grief on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Lord, in your mercy, grant us grace to entrust Michael to your never-failing love. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, and remember him according to the favor which you show to all your people. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, grant us, with all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, the fullness of life in your eternal and everlasting glory, and with all your saints to receive the crown of life promised to all who share in the victory of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. I invite you to stand with me for the commendation. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing nor life. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of mankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to the earth shall we return. For so did you decree, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Michael. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. is our shepherd. We shall not want. He makes us lie down in green pastures. He leads us beside still waters. He restores our soul. He leads us in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we will fear no evil. For you are with us. Your rod and your staff, they comfort us. You prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies. You anoint our head with oil. Our cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our life, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You're invited to join us for a reception downstairs in the Welcome Center, one floor down, and I'm sure there'll be an opportunity there to greet Ruth and Barbara if you would like to. Thank you for being here with us. Now receive the benediction. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.